Hey gamers, today we're going to look at A Castle for All Seasons. Let's check it out. To set up the game, what you're going to do is you're going to put these little frame pieces here, and there's a winter side and a summer side. You can tell by the edges there. This whole board flips over and the whole castle is in snow. It's really nice. It's a different level. It's a harder level for the game. But anyway, basically the game plays the same. You're going to take these little things, put it across the actual picture on the board. You'll put all those out here. You'll put the little dollar or pennies, I guess, the 1 buck coins across the board here. 2 to 4 players would be this long. 3 players to be this long. To be honest, you play it the whole way like that. It's fine. I'll use it all. This is a great game. Each player is going to start off with 6 players, 6 little pawns of their color. If it's a 2-player game, they will get a 7th pawn. They're also going to start off with 3 bucks. Denominations of money are in 3, 5s, and 1s. Also, each player is going to start off with sand and wood. On the construction crane here, you'll have 1 of each resource to start off the game with. Here's sand, here's stone, here's wood, here is silver, and this is brick. And so you'll put 1 of each resource starting right there. They're each going to have their little score tracker right there on the 0. Everyone is going to get all of the same cards, the same character cards, except they're going to be, their backs are going to be in their color. And they're going to get one of these little player aids to help you identify what the values are of each one of the resources. I'll talk about silver in a minute. And then, of course, this one kind of says, hey, here's the setup and here's what you do. Here's all the players in your deck here and here's what they do. So how the game's going to go is there's going to be a start player. They're going to hold this nice little castle piece here. And everyone's going to pick a card out of their hand. They're going to put it face down. And then they're going to all reveal together, and starting with the start player and then moving clockwise around, they're all going to resolve their card. So what do these cards do? Well, let's look at them. First one is the messenger. The messenger gives you 8 bucks. I know we say this a lot in board games, but money is extremely tight in this game. So he's going to be used quite often because he's just so special, though. He's the only one that's really going to give you money in the game. And you do need money in the game. Another character you can play is the trader. The trader allows you to take one of your men, as you see, and put it into a spot here that looks like that. It would be one of these 5 little spots here on the board. Now, they can go to any one. This one gives you 4 sand. This one gives you 3 wood. This one gives you 2 brick. This one gives you 2 stone. This one gives you 2 silver, but the only time you can go there is if all the other 4 are booked. Then you can go to silver. What this does is if you place your man down on any area, let's say I place him down on stone, then I would gather 2 stone. But whatever stone I get, 1 of that resource must always go to the crane. To the general public, you know. But there you go. You got some stone on your own. Same thing for brick. For wood, you would gather, it says 3 wood there, so you would get 2 wood, and then the crane would get 1. If you went to sand, you would get 3 sand, and that 4th sand would go to the crane. So eventually, this crane is going to be built up with a ton of resources, and I'll get to what that's going to help you with later on. But anyway, you can bump another player off of their spot if you want it instead. All that player does is they get this. Now, you can't recall these from the board, so once they're there, they do stay there for the game. You can only bump them off, but it is a nice way to get resources in the game. And again, that's the trader. The next one is the brick layer, the brick mason here. And what he does, if you look here, he looks at the little watchtower there, the little crane tower, and it says, what is this? He can get all of 1 resource. So let's say that the game kind of looks like this along the way, and I can get 1 of each resource, one of one kind of resource. Well, there's 3 stone here, so I can get away with 3 stone, and I can pick up all 3 stone. And that's really good because stone is worth a lot in the game. And then later on, if someone came by, maybe they'd say, well, I guess I'll take the 2 brick, or no, they probably want the 2 silver. So they take the 2 silver, and it kind of go from there. Now, of course, the crane's going to get more and more stuff as people take advantage of the trader thing. So I should also mention, if someone else plays their trader card, and let's say blue went here, well, not only would they get brick, but green would be able to get another thing of sand. They'd get three sand and deliver one to the crane. And then later on, let's say red played his, you know, trader, and he put him here. Well, then he would get wood, he would get brick, and he would get sand. So it keeps going on and on every time you have someone there, every time those spots are activated. If all four areas are filled up, let's say that green went here and then blue went there. Okay, well next time, if the only time those areas are going to get activated again is if another player comes in and bumps someone else off, then it activates everyone who's in those spots. But anyway, so that's one thing that the bricklayer can do. Next up, he can build. But he's building, instead of getting points, which is usually what you get on either of these things. If you see here, it says crowns or how many points you get. This is how many total resources that you need to use, the value of those resources. It has to be a mix of at least three out of the several, I think it's four or five resources if you count silver, that you have to use for each building. It's up to your discretion, but you need to meet the number on there. Like smaller things would be eight and only give you 6 points, and bigger things like this whole this building here, 30 points worth, but you get 18 victory points. Well, when you're building with the bricklayer, you're not getting those points, you're just getting coin. Remember I told you, coin is very important in the game. So you won't get much coin with him. In fact, you'll get one coin for every different resource you use. So the maximum you could get is four, maybe five coins if you threw in a silver in there. And so you're not getting that much, but you are getting a few coins for building him. And like I said, with a game with money is extremely tight, you will be using him to build. Now, whenever you build, you also get a chance to put one of your little meeple characters on one of the areas on the board. And these areas do various things. Now, the game kind of tells you, the instructions tell you exactly what they do. Sometimes you can look at the emblem here, and you can tell for every, and in fact, the board even tells you, for every person that you have within the castle walls, it's going to give you a victory point. If someone they had to pay 12 to get that spot. If they pay 6 coin, they can put a man there, and for every 2 men they have in the castle, they get an extra victory point. And all of these are really in-game victory points. Some of them count on, hey, if anyone, you know, for every little tower that's built, you're going to get 2 victory points. Or for every village that's built, you're going to get 3 victory points, but you got to pay 16 and put it there. Now, these buildings have to be built before those spaces come available, but they show you what's underneath it on the card on top. So now it'd be available, but unless someone built it, that spot would not be available yet. The only two spots that are available is the silversmith area. What the silversmith area is, silver can be exchanged for any good in the game. You're thinking, well, why wouldn't I want stone, right? Because stone costs the most. Well, because you don't get change back when you build anything, and you want to build with different materials. Believe me, I have traded in silver for sand before, just because I want different materials, especially when we're talking about the bricklayer. So you can go to the silversmith here and exchange it for any type of good. Now, if you were able to pay $10 here, for every silver that gets put in there, it stays there, and you're going to get a victory point. If someone were to go here, they count out how many silver bars are there, and for every 2, they would get a victory point. It costs less, but it's harder to get those points. Down in the festival area here, if you pay, 2 people can pay 6 each, and for every 2 coins they can generate coins for points. Now, coins for points do not count at the end of the game, but you can get them this way by placing in those 2 spots. So different areas on the board will give you different things. Like I said, the rule book tells you what each one does. But when you build, that is the only way you can put people in those spots. And it says a maximum of 2 this turn. If he chose not to build, just get resources, then he may not place anyone. And the same will go for our next 3 people. These are builders here. And these builders build for crown. They build for victory points. So here, what does this count for? Well, whenever you play one of these workers, you're going to get the resources here. So this guy gives you a brick and 2 sand. This guy gives you a silver and 2 wood. This guy gives you a stone and 2 others of your choice. It cannot be stone and it cannot be silver. So only 1 stone there. So you get some resources and you have the option to build. A lot of this is option to build. Okay. Now you can't place a man afterwards, so you're just building. So you may want them building some of the smaller things around town. Maybe you want to build some of the bigger things to get those victory points, but they can't place a man after they built. Only this guy can. Well, the bricklayer too, but the stonemason can as well. Now the stonemason, as you see here, it has the three worker cards I just showed you, and it shows this miscellaneous resource. What it means, remember, you're all playing these cards simultaneously face down. When you all flip them over and you see people have a builder, you may take one resource from that builder and without their not, you know, without their okay. Like if someone played this guy, I want his stone. Well, I only had to pay a dollar. That's a terrible deal for stone. Stone's hard to come by. But now I got a stone. Ha ha ha. Because I can force someone to buy, I can buy anything from any one of these three builders. So again, this is like a fake and double fake game, you know. You don't want people knowing what your next move is because someone could play someone like this and steal one of your resources. And then finally, this is another one. This is the master builder. What he does is he takes back all your cards and puts them back into your hand. Now, what this little build symbol is, it says 5 here. That means for anyone who builds that round, you're going to get 5 victory points. And this is really good if you feel like 2 or 3 players in the game are going to be building. You definitely want to play this. Even though you may not want to pick up your cards yet, you're saying, I see these two people want to build. I may want to play this game, this card. So even though they built and made some victory points, you got, you know, 5, 10, up to maybe 15 victory points for their building. That's very smart on when to play this game, when to play this card. All these cards are like that. I should also mention that Stonemason, he builds for points too, and that's the only other way you can place people on the board. Now, you want to place people on the board because that's how you're going to get your in-game points. At the end of the game ends, and by the way, after one turn, someone passes this around to the next player. That player takes the next coin on the track and they keep going. So everyone's getting a coin and they're going to keep going. When the coins are done, that means the turns are over, you finish the round, and then add up in-game victory points, and whoever has the most victory points wins. Now real quick, I wanted to show you the other half of the game here. You can also play it in winter time, and basically you'd be putting all these back up over the sites here and doing it all over again. But the difference is you have these winter cards. These are event cards, and usually they're very bad, and every round you'd flip one over. Actually, it would tell you on the 4th, 6th, 9th, 11th, 13th, and 14th turn, you're going to flip over one of these bad cards. It just makes the game a little bit harder, but the artwork, beautiful. Final thoughts, what do I think about the game? Wow, you know, I've never heard about this game before. I don't even know how I came across it, too. I think it was a complete accident. I saw it in someone's auction. I was like, what is that? And the artwork is beautiful. The gameplay is fun. You know, you're playing one card at a time. The game goes really quick, too. If everyone knows what their characters are, you can play this game in about an hour. I mean, to be honest, because everyone knows what they're doing. They're taking their turns. They're making their buildings. But when you play certain cards, that's where the strategy is. When am I going to play? I see people, you know, people are hoarding, supplies. I think they're going to build this round. I think, even though I don't need to pick up my cards, like one time I only had to pick up like one card, but went ahead and played it, and everyone's like, oh man. And so now, do they build? Yeah, they all built, and I got 15 free points. It was like awesome. Awesome. I don't know how often that would happen, but you time it just right. You play your masonry when you know that someone's going to play builder, so you can buy and steal those certain ones. Man, the first game I ever did, I didn't realize, you know, you needed all the different types of supplies there, the different, I can't think what they are, just supplies. And I had lots of materials, I guess. I had lots of stone, and stone was the most expensive. And then it started getting where I needed wood and sand bad. And I mean, it's kind of funny. You want a good balance of it because you need it to build certain things. Also, when you're building with a brick mason, you think, I'll never build for that. Giving up points just to get some coin? But you need coin. I've never played a game where coin is this tight. I've never done that. Where you place, you want to, when you build, you want to place people in those areas. Because when you build, there's only two cards that you place people. You've got to build with the brick mason to place people. And you may not want to build. I want the victory points. I don't want to do this. But you say, well, no, I got to get, you know, some of those. I got to put some of my men down here. So you build with them anyway. It's wonderful. And where you put your characters at the end, that makes a huge difference. Now, this one in the winter one, there's not really that much except those winter cards. They suck. They're awful. You don't want to play with those. Play in the regular summer round first. And then after a while, try the winter round. It is fun too. I see this game pretty cheap, I think, as of this video. It's nothing new I haven't seen before, but just the artwork and that, of course, you're collecting resources, but playing different cards, one card to pick them all up. But when you play, those cards are very important. Really fun game. Really fun. I don't know why it's not talked about it more. Anyway, gamers, that's all the time I have for now. Until next time, you know what to do. Game on!